Tonight, in-person classes resume in the Philippines more than 2 years since the start of the COVID pandemic.
Classes in several northern Philippine provinces suspended due to bad weather.
A fourth monkeypox case detected in the Philippines.
And Ukraine's president warns of intensified Russian attacks ahead of his country's Independence Day.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, millions of students returned to classrooms across the Philippines for the first time since the COVID pandemic began. Philippine Vice President and Education Chief Sara Duterte insists the health crisis is no longer an excuse to keep children from schools. Joyce Balancho has tonight's top story.
Dito, dito. 2 years since the COVID-19 pandemic, more children are now back to in-person classes in public schools. In Parañaque National High School, 16,000 students are enrolled this year. It has the biggest population of junior and senior high school students in the Philippines.
Sa sobrang tagal na hindi nakakita ng ibang tao, ngayon na lang po ulit makakilala at makakasalamuan ng iba. Nung online class po, parang hindi po masyado na-explain ng maayos. Mas madali po ngayong face-to-face.
According to the Department of Education, more than 28 million learners have enrolled this year and schools are still accepting late enrollees this week. No problem or issue has been reported during the Monday's school opening. Only class suspensions in Cagayan and Tuguegarao due to Typhoon Florita.
So we have been monitoring the situation since around 4 a.m. this morning. At maganda naman pong balita because wala, so far, smooth pa po ang opening of our classes. Wala naman pong mga major incidents that was brought to our attention since this morning.
Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte visited a school in Bataan Province. She says the pandemic should not be a reason to keep students from schools.
Isang malaking tagumpay para sa mga kabataang Pilipino ang muling pagsisimula ng in-person learning ngayong araw na ito. Isang hakbang na buong tapang na ginawa ng Department of Education sa kabila ng mga hamon at takot na dala ng COVID-19 pandemic. Hindi po natin binabalewala ang mga pangamba na dulot ng pandemya.
She also has some reminders for students.
Paalala namin sa ating mga learners, sa ating mga anak, na hindi ang inyong mga magulang, hindi ang paaralan, hindi ang inyong mga guro ang magpapabago ng buhay ninyo. Kayo at ang inyong determinasyon ang magpapabago ng buhay ninyo. Pagtuunan nyo ng pansin ang sariling buhay ninyo, ang pag-aaral ninyo, ang inyong kaligayahan, at huwag ninyong pagtuunan ng pansin ang buhay ng inyong mga classmates.
DepEd maintained that full face-to-face learning should be enforced starting November, but as early as now, almost all schools in Bataan are already implementing this. In Dinalupihan Elementary School, students will attend face-to-face classes for 5 days starting this week. Outside their classrooms are signs to remind students of health protocols. They also placed foot bath, alcohol station, and thermal scanners. Bataan Public Schools have protocols in place in case a student or a teacher shows symptoms of COVID infection.
Meron tayong pinut up na mga triage, no? Meron tayong mga pinut up na isolation facilities. And then ang SOP natin dyan, we will closely coordinate with our local government and our Department of Health para kung meron tayong mga possible infected, even teachers or learners.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. also welcomes the return of children to full face-to-face classes after 2 years of distance learning. He believes that learning will be more effective inside classrooms where students fully interact with their teachers and classmates. He adds, Since the threat of COVID-19 remains, it is important for teachers and students to continue observing the minimum health protocols. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
The implementation of COVID-19 protocols still a challenge as physical classes resume in some of the Philippines' most populated schools. Ara Perez tells us the steps being taken to address safety concerns.
Teacher Wilma shed tears of joy on the first day of full face-to-face classes at EMS Signal Village Elementary School in Taguig. This day was made even more special because among her students is Michael, a learner with special needs. The school is open to special education students and to kinder to grade 6, ALS, and madrasa or Muslim education.
Sa loob ng 2 taon, ngayon po ulit makakasama yung aking mga estudyante. Ngayon talagang face-to-face is real na talaga. Hindi talaga ako nakatulog dahil excited din po. Ibig sabihin, ganun din yung mga bata.
Siya po ay isang autism spectrum disorder po. Mahilig naman po siya magsulat at saka mag-drawing. Nakakabasa naman po siya. Kaya lang po, sa ganyang case po niya, may iba po talagang words na hindi po niya mabanggit.
The school administration admits it's a challenge to implement health protocols, but vows to do their best. According to the school, it is better to see what needs to be improved early on so that there will no longer be adjustments come November 2, when full face-to-face classes in all schools take effect. A limited number of students were allowed in the quadrangle for the flag ceremony. The teacher-student ratio is 1:45, so physical distancing remains a challenge. The canteen is closed and recess is held inside the classroom. Disinfection is done after classes and during weekends. Marshals wait outside to manage the influx of people during class start and dismissal.
Pakiusap ko lang po sa mga parents, dapat dumating sila dun sa schedule talaga nila, huwag masyadong maaga kasi mayroong lalabas, may schedule na lalabas, tapos nandiyan na sila, mamaya pa naman sila papasok.
The school has devised an infection containment strategy in coordination with the barangay and local government unit.
Pag masama ang pakiramdam ng bata, huwag nang papapasukin. In case na magkaroon ng fever ang bata sa room, dadalhin sa clinic, tatawagan yung magulang at ipapasukin.
A party list lawmaker says the education department should have imposed guidelines on class size before schools reopened for in-person learning. ACT Teachers Representative Franz Castro says she visited Apolonio Elementary School in Quezon City this morning and found students cramped inside classrooms.
May problema kasi tayo sa memo. Walang guidelines on the number of students per class. It should have been written in the memo. Oh, to maintain physical distancing, dapat ay 20 to 25 a class kasi talagang nagka-cramp ang mga students sa isang classroom.
Senator Grace Poe, meanwhile, says the country could have been better prepared for the reopening of classes. She says all concerns hounding the sector, like public transport system, should have been addressed first. In Parañaque National High School, Maine, with 17,000 enrollees, highest in the Philippines and in Asia, there are days for in-person classes and for online. The school premises and surroundings are filled with signages as reminders on health protocols. For a teacher's group, the first day of classes is generally peaceful and orderly. The Teachers Dignity Coalition lauds the coordination between local governments, police officers, parents, and other stakeholders. But it points out a lot of issues remain unaddressed, like the shortage in classrooms, as well as the inadequate number of teachers. The group remains hopeful the Education Department will respond to their concerns. Ara Perez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Social Welfare Department taps local governments to help ensure a more orderly distribution of educational cash aid. Thousands had flocked to social welfare offices across the country last weekend, hoping to receive the cash assistance for indigent students. But huge crowds and lack of clear guidelines led to chaotic situations that left several people injured.
Gusto po namin ilapit na itong educational assistance sa mga bata sa bawat bayan, bawat lungsod ng ating bansa. Para hindi na po sila maglandarapa, magpapila, magtulakan sa mga tanggapan ng DSWD. Ang mga LGU, ang magsasabi kung saan ang payout sa kanilang mga bayan, sa kanilang mga lugar.
Local governments had previously faced criticism that aid was not fairly distributed to their constituents during pandemic lockdowns. The president of the League of Cities calls on the Social Welfare Department to put more trust in local governments and have better coordination in handing out the educational aid.
DSWD, kulang ng manpower yan. Yung manpower, nandyan sa local government unit through DSWS at saka yung mga mismong human resource from the barangays. Pinaka-importante sana na mag-re-respetuhay saka mag-i-establish ng trust and confidence na financial assistance. It cannot definitely be as effective, efficient, and orderly if there is no close coordination.
Over 53,000 indigent Filipino students received educational aid from government over the weekend.
Recent calamities and ongoing bad weather hamper the opening of classes in parts of the Philippines. Gracie Rutao tells us some schools that were flooded canceled classes altogether.
In low-lying areas of Makabebe, Pampanga, the students struggle through one-foot-deep waters in the barangays of Saplad David, Kadwangtete, and San Gabriel just to get to school. San Vicente San Francisco National High School remains flooded from recent rains, and the flooded areas include a covered court and some classrooms. They had to walk on sandbags or chairs to avoid getting wet, but school officials remain undaunted.
Gagawa kami ng mga pathway para interlink, no? Naka-interlink lahat mga kwarto. But again, may mga challenges pa yung sa arapan na yun. Napakalaking chance kasi may dadaan na sasakyan. Kaya sandbagging.
Flooding is not new to schools in Masantol Town. Authorities say about 22 elementary and high school are affected by flooding. Aside from flood safety, Pampanga Vice Governor Lilia Pineda reminds students to observe minimum health standards to prevent the spread of COVID-19.
Dapat mag-ano rin sila nung distancing at saka yung observation nila. Anong ingat nang gagawin nila? Hindi yung parang, sa tingin ko kanina, parang wala eh. Parang wala na silang iniintinding Omicron, parang wala na silang iniintinding COVID. Parang back to normal. Dapat naman, hindi ganun.
In San Miguel Town in the province of Bulacan, some classrooms are also underwater. In Doña Damiana de Leon Macam Memorial Elementary School, a stage has been turned into a classroom.
Magkakaroon ng simultaneous dredging sa main rivers ang ating lalawigan. Mapapansin mo talaga dati, yung mga kalsadang pinagpatong-patong na namin.
Rains brought by Tropical Storm Florita triggered floods in Cagayan Province. Flood waters reached many schools, including the school in the town of Alacapan and the Libertad National High School in Abulug Town. School officials eventually decided to send the students home. Other schools in the province suspended classes. One kindergarten in Lawag City also stopped classes after storm signal number 1 was hoisted over Ilocos Norte province. Classes were suspended in Legazpi City, Albay due to torrential rains. Class suspension in all levels was also implemented in Ginobatan, Albay due to potential floods. Parents, students, and teachers were stranded in Pasig City, Iloilo due to damaged bridge. They had to board a raft to cross the river. The bridge was damaged during Typhoon Agaton. Gracie Rutao, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine government's chief economist, optimistic the reopening of schools will spur growth. Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Arsenio Balisacan says the return of students to physical classes will revitalize the service sector and small and medium enterprises.
Malaki yun dahil yung mga, di ba, services sector yun, from transport to food to, lalo na yung sa mga micro enterprises, small and medium enterprises. Malaki yun sa ano. Kasi as I said earlier, services sector is really going to be the at least the driver, no, for the near term. No?
Balisakan's predecessor, Carl Chua, earlier called the halt of face-to-face classes as a driver of economic loss during the pandemic. Chua had projected that the resumption of in-person classes would generate about 12 billion pesos in economic activity.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. sees a 5.29 trillion peso national budget from lawmakers to fund government projects in his first year in office. RG Cruz tells us which sectors are getting the biggest outlay for 2023.
The Department of Budget and Management has submitted to the House of Representatives the 2023 National Expenditure Program worth 5.268 trillion pesos, 4.9% higher than the 2022 budget. Education takes the biggest chunk of next year's spending plan, among others that funds free college tuition, facilities and learning materials, assistance and scholarships. Infrastructure spending is second, with money allocated to the construction of more roads and railways. Health gets the third biggest allocation, with provisions to buy more COVID-19 vaccines.
It is in under the unprogrammed fund because we still have vaccines in our inventory. But once na sinabing meron ng kailangan ulit kung bumili ng mga yung ano sa reformatted vaccines, we have sufficient cover under the unprogrammed appropriation. If I'm not mistaken, mga 20 plus billion yun eh.
Different agencies will also be giving away various assistance. But the DBM admits the spending plan doesn't cover yet the additional pension for indigent senior citizens.
The law lapsed into law after the budget has already been completed. So we did not provide. That's around 24.5 billion pesos. So we would like to defer to the wisdom of Congress on this, although we will be providing them with the utilization rates of various departments so that they will at least know where it can be sourced.
Rounding up the top five, agriculture spending, with the National Rice Program getting 30 billion pesos. The National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict, or NTFL-CAC, remains alive, though spending under its barangay development program will be subject to guidelines. There's also money for the poorest local government units.
Ito po yung LCAC. Ang budget po natin siya ng this year is 5.62, and then we increase it to 10 billion for 2023. And kasama din po dito yung budget po natin for Growth Equity Fund. Ito po yung pondo for our 4th, 5th, and 6th municipalities and barangays po para mabigyan po natin sila ng mga enough programs and projects po para at least po makaabot po sila dun sa mga mas mataas na mga municipalities po. And we also have the financial assistance to LGUs po of 5 billion pesos.
The House vowed to give final approval before October 1, when Congress is scheduled to go on its first recess that will last up to November.
And we have committed to the executive its swift passage for its signing to law before the end of the year.
The House already began pre-budget briefings in a bid to resolve lawmakers' individual concerns and minimize debates. The DBM hopes to have the President sign the budget into law by Christmas. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Next in the news, the Philippines logs its fourth case of the monkeypox virus.
This and other stories when the World Tonight returns.
Back on the World Tonight, former Philippine officials involved in a sugar importation controversy justify their actions to House lawmakers. Meanwhile, sugar prices are expected to drop below the level at which major supermarkets earlier agreed to sell the commodity. Jervis Manahan tells us why.
Resigned officials from the Department of Agriculture and the Sugar Regulatory Administration faced lawmakers in person during the House of Representatives probe about the mess involving Sugar Order No. 4. former SRA Administrator Hermenegildo Serafica maintained that it was low supply that prompted them to craft the order and that they consulted stakeholders in the process.
There are previous sugar orders in the SRA that we take into consideration on the necessity on every type of program.
But upon questioning by Antipolo Congressman Romeo Acop, Serafica admitted some protocols were not followed.
Did you follow the protocols? Even without MC number one, sinunod mo ba yung protocol? Yes or no?
No, Your Honor.
Bakit hindi nyo ginawa yung protocol in accordance with your manual?
I was a victim of MC one, Memorandum Circular number one. When it came out, the three deputies and the legal department manager talked among themselves that, you know, our term ended on June 30, 2022.
Former Undersecretary Leocadio Sebastian said he signed the order in good faith and in line with his duties based on a memorandum circular that stated he can sign on the president's behalf.
Signed for the Secretary of Agriculture.
Yeah, but he's also the President of the Republic of the Philippines.
Based on the authority given to me in a July 15 memorandum by the Executive Secretary. The memorandum, Mr. Chair, states that I will sit as ex officio chairman or member of all duly constituted committees, councils, boards, or bodies where the Secretary of Agriculture is a member, and I therefore participated in good faith.
But Sebastian admitted he may have misunderstood the president.
When he disapproved it, I immediately gave my resignation out of delicadeza.
Sugar remains one of the focus areas of the Department of Agriculture. Agriculture Senior Undersecretary Domingo Panganiban says the price of sugar may go down to 60 pesos per kilo following government's discovery of sugar stocks in several warehouses. Major supermarkets have already committed to sell sugar at 70 pesos per kilo this week.
Makaapekto yung presyo ng supermarket over sa mga tienda. Bababa pa siguro ng mga 10 hanggang 15 peso. Siguro 70, 60. Pwede siguro bumaba 60.
Opo.
So dahil kung yung maraming supply na isipin mo sa Bulacan, apat ng warehouses.
Panganiban says the planned importation will push through by the end of October. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
New appointees are sworn in to replace the Philippine sugar regulatory officials who resigned over a botched importation order. Philippine President Marcos Jr. administered the oath to the new sugar regulatory administrator, David John Tadeos Alba, and to board members Pablo Luis Ascona and Maria Mitzi Mangwag. Alba replaces resigned SRA Administrator Hermenegildo Serafica. Ascona will represent sugar planters, while Mangwag will be the sugar miller's representative in the board. President Marcos Jr. expressed confidence that the new officials can help him solve the country's sugar supply problems. He earlier vowed to reorganize the SRA, which he also chairs as Agriculture Secretary. New COVID-19 cases in the Philippines stay below the 3,000 mark. Health officials logged 3,777 more infections on Monday. Some 1,168 of that figure were from the capital region. Active cases are at over 33,700, while 29 COVID-related deaths were also reported.
The Philippines detects its fourth case of the monkeypox virus. The health department says it's a 25-year-old Filipino with no travel history to countries with cases of the disease. The patient is currently in an isolation facility. 14 of the patient's close contacts have also been identified. One of them is in the same isolation facility as the patient. Six others are in quarantine, while another one is self-monitoring after being assessed as low risk for the disease. The details of the remaining six are still being verified. The health department says all four confirmed monkeypox cases in the Philippines are unrelated to each other.
Tropical storm Florita maintains its strength as it continues to move westward over the Philippine Sea east of Aurora. State Weather Bureau Pagasa reports Florita was last spotted 145 kilometers east of Kasiguran, Aurora. It is moving westward slowly with maximum sustained winds of 75 kilometers per hour near the center and gustiness of up to 90 kilometers per hour. Storm signal number 2 is hoisted in more than a dozen provinces, including Cagayan, Isabela, Kalinga, and Ifugao. Signal number 1 is up in more than a dozen provinces, including La Union, Nueva Ecija, and Camarines Norte.
Russia fires an artillery barrage on a city near Ukraine's Zaporizhia nuclear plant. The region's governor says the overnight shelling of Nikopol caused a fire at an industrial plant and cut power to 3,000 residents. The attacks in the vicinity of Europe's biggest nuclear plant heightened fears of a nuclear accident. Ukraine President Volodymyr Zelensky now warns Russia may do something particularly cruel as his country prepares to mark its independence from Soviet rule on Wednesday, August 24th. The date will also mark 6 months since Russia began its unprovoked invasion of Ukraine.
Russia's Gazprom to halt deliveries of natural gas through its main pipeline to Europe. Gazprom claims the Nord Stream 1 pipeline needs to undergo 3 days of maintenance at the end of the month. This is a blow to Europe as it seeks to refuel ahead of winter. The shutdown is also seen to further hurt Germany. Its central bank chief says the country's inflation rate could surge to over 10% amid the energy squeeze. German Chancellor Olaf Scholz is visiting Canada in an effort to secure the country's energy supplies. The PSE index becomes the worst performer in Asia on Monday. But one analyst says the pullback was already expected. Michelle Long reports.
Stocks in Asia traded mixed on Monday as concerns over aggressive Fed rate hikes reemerged after some Fed officials recently hinted that more hikes are coming to fight inflation. Investors also looking ahead to the Fed's annual Jackson Hole Economic Symposium, which begins Thursday. Meanwhile, in China, the central bank headed the other way, cutting its one-year benchmark lending rate by 5 basis points to 3.65%, its five-year rate by 15 basis points to 4.3%. As for the Philippines, the index started the week on the back foot, suffering its biggest one-day drop since end of June. COL Financial Investment Management's Marvin Fausto is not surprised, saying the recent run-up was too much too soon and consolidation is only expected. His advice, look to RTBs.
When I look at the investments, I look at relative value. You have to look at it on the risk-free comparative. And I think the big thing that's going to happen this week, probably the RTB, the retail treasury bond offering. We've seen that offered 400 billion to 500 billion. And that's going to take a lot of liquidity in the market. And when you look at the stock market, you have to look at it on relative value, as well as the way you are in your portfolio. I always say I'm a advocate of asset allocation. I look at now at 60-40 in favor of fixed income. For as long as your fixed income gives you a yield of about net of 4% net of tax, it is still good to invest in risk-free assets, and then you will command a higher risk premium on equities because it's riskier, right? So you have to look at it on that balance. If you're below 40% on your equities, then it's okay. There are a lot of things happening coming, but I think it's the RTB. If RTB goes below 5.4, that will be a net of about 4.3 net of the 20% tax. So it's still a good risk-free investment as far as retail investors are concerned. So relative to the equities, you have to look at it on your portfolio on an asset allocation basis.
For the day, the PSE index lost 2.3% or 160 points to close just a touch above 6,700, with decliners beating advancers 2-1. In corporate stories, BPI bullish about the Philippine banking system and the robust spending of Filipino consumers. TG Limcauco, who heads one of the oldest banks in Southeast Asia, says credit card spending is up 30% from pre-pandemic levels, deposits growth at 14.5%. Its auto book and mortgage books are also holding steady.
Historically, the Philippines has always had very high rate levels. And when you look at who are being impacted today, I think the first ones who are being impacted by the increase in the rates, the policy rates of the BSP, are the top corporates, because they've always paid rates that are very close to the policy rate or the government rates.
The Ayala Group's BPI saw first half profit jump 73% to 20.4 billion pesos thanks to a record second quarter performance and an asset sale. In other news, Petron Corporation confirms plans to spend up to 15 billion pesos annually for the expansion of its operations through 2025. 70% of that will be allocated for Philippine operations and 30% for Malaysia. Meanwhile, Benguet Corporation of the Romualdez family saw consolidated net income almost double to 553 million pesos in the second quarter, bringing first half profit to 974 million. The company cites higher nickel ore exports, rising metal prices, and favorable foreign exchange for the bump up. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines' first family throws a surprise birthday party for First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos. Video uploaded to the YouTube channel of President Marcos Jr. shows him and his sons ushering the First Lady to their living room, where guests greeted her with a birthday song. President Marcos gave a short message thanking the First Lady for being his partner in life. Among the guests at the weekend surprise party were the President's mother, First Lady Imelda Marcos, and his cousin, House Speaker Martin Romualdez. Our final word tonight is a quote from Don Draper. "People tell you who they are, but we ignore it because we want them to be who we want them to be."
And that is The World Tonight, the 22nd of August, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!